And welcome to our latest, I think this is our sixth webinar now in the African Diaspora series. And I'm particularly excited for this one. I always am excited, but this one I'm particularly excited for because we are going to be going to territory that we haven't gone into yet in terms of the arts and culture field, and specifically music in this case. So I think it's going to be a very exciting presentation. If you were coming in, you heard me saying how many people are just coming in now and saying, please send me the link now, and they really want to be part of this. So it's very exciting that people are very invested in this and very excited about it. So it's great to have everyone here. I'll just introduce Dipo in a minute, but just to let you know what I've dropped in the chat. If you look at the chat, you will see a link which will give you the information, Dipo's bio and the abstract for the presentation itself. On this link as well, if you link to past webinars, you will see our past webinars as well as the YouTube links which Hunter's put up for those. So recordings of those sessions. So if you want to look at those, they'll be available there. This one will also be available on that YouTube channel should you want to, if you're interested in checking that out as well. And then I'm not going to spend too much time talking now because I want to introduce Dipo Uyelele, University of Wisconsin-Madison. As I said, his information is in the bio. And the title of his presentation is Sounds from the Other Side, African Popular Music in the Age of Technoculture. So Dipo will speak for an hour, then we'll have 15 minutes or more for questions. And then afterwards, I'll tell you about, give you an indication of what our next webinar will be about and when. Dipo, thank you so much for joining us and for being here. We're all, as you see, everyone's very excited. So thank you.
Thank you for having me. Before going to the presentation, let me just start by saying thank you to the African Center for the Study of the United States at the University of Witwatersrand. Did I pronounce it well? I want to appreciate Dr. Yeah. Adam Levin for discovering me through his friend, Hunter. And this happy coincidence culminated in the presentation that I'm about to give. Thanks to everyone for taking some time out of this incredibly precarious time to listen to this presentation. Barring unforeseen circumstances such as network problems and some videos in the slide not loading, I'm hoping this will be a time well spent together. Now, I would like to start with this introduction. And it is said that music knows no boundaries. It is more accurate to say that it redefines them. This particular quote is very crucial to how I've been thinking about, you know, contemporary African popular music and what has changed and where we are, where we're supposed, we are going with it, and how it is changing the landscape of sound globally. So, before I go into this, my objectives basically is to, number one, discuss how this sound proliferates, and secondly, to talk about how Afropolitanism works as a framework for us to understand this spread, this itinerant subjectivity of not just people, but also sound. And to make a claim for how, you know, the era, the age of information, the age of technology has created a different kind of culture around how sound travels and around how people create a network of sociality around the sound. But before I get into that, I have to say that music is one of the most portable cultural materials that travel with little to no impediments. And it has always been at the forefront of the Black diasporic experience. Paul Gilroy in Black Atlantic considers Black musics as the grudging gifts of cultural expression of the Black Atlantic that provides an enhanced mode of communication beyond the petty power of words, spoken or written. That is, music is vital to the Black diasporic experience in the most fundamental way for its value as an effective expressive form in the most constraining of circumstances. In this regard, we may think of how it is employed by Africans who are captured and sold into slavery through the Middle Passage. Music has served as an outlet for preserving certain aspects of cultural memory, a coping mechanism for human suffering, and as a tool for dealing with a broad range of concerns from trauma to pleasure to the celebration of life. In African diasporic experience, we may think about its movement through a transcontinental link in Afro-Cuban, Afro-Caribbean, African-American, and African iterations of musical production and circulation. The Nigerian musician that you see on your screen, Lagbaja, explains this movement of sound quite succinctly in Africa Lipso. I mean, since we have an hour, I think it's a good time to also enjoy music and take our time and, you know, proceed without rushing through the slides. And I hope you find this as enjoyable as I did putting them together. So this is Africa Lipso, and what it does is to give us like the history of how music travels in its own unique way. Leave it to play for like 7 minutes straight because it's a 7 minutes track, but we have other things to talk about. So If you're listening closely, not just to the musical arrangement, not just to the to what it's saying, but the musical arrangement, you would see that it says stuff and the main backup singer repeats it. That is actually in keeping with the Black tradition of a call and response, the technical term for it is antiphony. You know, like you say stuff, I respond, you know. And that is also a call, you know, things that, you know, enslaved Africans also find as a way to communicate, maybe in codes or in languages that they are forbidden to speak. So they find a way to use this call and response to connect. Even like when you think about the history of Underground Railroad, I mean, when they want to, when some of these people want to take some slaves to freedom, one of the signals is usually like a song, like Go Down Moses, you know. I mean, that is like archived in, you know, when you think about African-American spirituals, you know, all these songs, you know, talking about freedom, let my people go, and all of that. So there's that call and response that comes with it. And but to the subject that Lagbaja tries to portray here, is talking about the history of how sounds spread. And he started his own historiography with the Middle Passage, you know, when they took away the forefathers and they took along their music and some, you know, mutated into different forms and into different sounds. And also it tries to give us like an idea of a global Africa, of a world that is spread in terms of not just geography and territoriality, but one that is spread by the idea of a movement of sounds that is not really particularly domiciled in a space, in a particular space. So the body can be a slave, but never the spirit. So wherever there's soul in the music, behind it, you find an African. And I think what he's talking about is that the call of sounds, where regardless of where it is that there's this essence, this essence of it that tells a story, that embodies a history, and that embodies a sort of a social dimension that culturally ties that sound, regardless of what it's called or what it is, to Africa as a cradle of humanity and civilization. So Lagbaja's brief historiography, musically presented, provides for us a roadmap to how I intend to proceed in this presentation. As it notes, the spread of the African sound to other parts of the world may be tied to the dispersal of Africans, in this particular case, through the capitalist mercantilism, which necessitated the Middle Passage in the transportation of Africans as slaves. Lagbaja reiterates the fact that music has been a vital aspect of Black diasporic experience, as long as there's soul in music behind it's an African, regardless of the affinated identity, whether it's Afro-Cuban, African-American, Afro-Caribbean, whatever affination you put to it. Going off of this idea, we may examine music's instrumental role in the idea of post-national citizenship and the attendant constraints of national bureaucratic formalities and passport regime. Basically, music travels without visa, music travels without, I mean, you know, there have been attempts to like ban some kind of sound in different kind of struggle. I mean, like think about apartheid and jazz and how, you know, there's been a lot of ways to want to restrain, even like on the slave plantation, there were like ideas that slave masters had to suppress certain musical inventions because they feel it could lead to a revolution. And at the forefront of every kind of movement, there's always sound, there's always music, from the civil rights movement to like different kinds of struggle. Music is a component that unifies, that creates a kind of synergy that you that words alone don't carry. So in this sense, in different manifestations of the sound, there's always a gesture, whether deliberate, accidental, to the cross-cultural and trans-historical global flow. And this movement of sound also influences the artistic process of contemporary music making and dissemination. These and many other musings on contemporary African music informed this presentation's critical examination of Africa's traveling sounds and its diaspora in the 21st century. So my focus basically is not to essentially go back down in history, but to talk about what is happening now. And for those who joined later, I was talking to Adam about, you know, how popular culture generally is kind of like an unstable thing. You know, it's fleeting. Different musical styles come, different dance movements come, you know, over the time when you think about music, even like in your particular location, there's been an evolving way that sound moves, and you know, and the way it moves people as well. So essentially the 21st century has its specific, I mean, we still live in the 21st century, it's an ongoing process. So these observations I'm making, perhaps in the next 10 years, things will change and it will be something else that we'll be talking about. But at the moment, these movements of sound influences the artistic process of contemporary music making and how it's disseminated. As noted in the objective for this talk, I'm rethinking African popular music with this historical antecedents in mind. While claiming Africa in relation to music may be too broad to unpack in a presentation, my goal is to draw on samples across the continent to underscore Afropolitanism as a framework for reading post-2000 soundscape. This move allows me to map the significance of the concept as a connecting node for reading global Africa. And in a minute, I'll explain some of these words that I'm throwing around. So Afropolitanism has been defined in different ways. People have different ideas of what it is. A lot of people think it's just this elitist stuff about some people who could, you know, generally move and travel to different spaces, ignoring some of us in other parts of the world who are unable to move, and who do we call an Afropolitan? But that's not the crux of my presentation. I am focusing on Afropolitanism as a theory of reading, you know, this sensibility, the awareness of this imbrication of here and elsewhere, the presence of the elsewhere in the here and vice versa, this relativization of roots and primary belongings, and a way of embracing, fully cognizant of origins, the foreign, the strange, the distant, this capacity to recognize oneself in the face of another and to value the traces of the distance within the proximate, to domesticate the unfamiliar and to work with all manner of contradictions. That cultural sensibility, as Achille Mbembe tries to posit the historical and aesthetics of it, is what defines Afropolitanism, broadly construed. And when we extrapolate some of these key points, we begin to see how, even though we might not necessarily label people as, you know, this person is Afropolitan, this person is not, you know, all those arguments, but we can see how some of these ideas permeate through, you know, our societies in different parts of the world that we live in, regardless of our estate in life, whether we are middle class or, you know, lower class, and whichever, you know, commune we belong, this idea circulates in how our societies have been transforming. And so from that definition and several others, I try to come up with how these ideas can be thought of as a framework. And because, you know, you can throw terms around, but how does it work? How do we use it to make, you know, cogent analysis, to stake claim, and to really show how this whole thing works? And I came up with three attributes that I call the tripartite attributes of Afropolitanism. And the first one is fluidity. As you can see, it's the notion of plasticity. That is the capacity to embrace what is new, what is novel, the eagerness to experiment with the new. And when we look at, you know, Africa today, like if you go to different countries, even though people say, oh, you know, China is investing a lot, China is building bridges and all of that. I mean, even like China or no China, when you look at how both urban and rural areas have transformed and what we have made of our modernity, you can tell that there's always this ability to adapt, this ability to stretch, this ability to contract, this ability to remake things, remake ideas, and make them seem as if, you know, it's originally ours. People do that with things, you know. You buy a used car and you do something else with it, and you change some stuff in it, and you customize it to kind of like fit or suit your sense of taste. But like that is like giving a physical metaphor to the idea. But plasticity, you know, is what defines the movement and development that we are seeing all around us, and that also leads to access. Now, with access, we are thinking about the mechanism that enable, you know, all kinds of movements, the mechanism that makes it possible for us to cross boundaries, barriers, to encounter, innovate, and blend in the global flow. Because Africa, you know, as most people would want to think that Africa is stuck in a time warp, Africa's participation in the global commons is such that it's defined not necessarily by being different from the rest of the world, and not necessarily by aping what is happening in the rest of the world. It's like a complex way that different ideas come together to form this uniqueness. That when you are in Johannesburg, there's a structure of feeling there. When you find yourself in Lagos or in Nairobi, in different parts of the world, there's this structure of feeling that you get from how the society operates, how things move. So what are the mechanisms that could make this possible in general terms, but also in terms of how these musical compositions exist? And this you can apply this also to maybe a novel or the different works, even like visual arts, like paintings and things that contemporary artists are doing. So network, the third one, depends on access to build this connectivity matrix. And the network explains the social, experiential, historical, whether it's transnational, regional, subnational, cross-generational links and connections to global cultural flow and exchange. And basically, this is why, you know, for instance, you can listen to, you know, South African house music in Nigeria, even though you don't speak the language, you connect with it on a particular level. You know, like when I've been in Nigeria in a club and Jerusalem comes up and, you know, the atmosphere changes, and you know, you see all this kind of stuff going on there. And people, the way we relate to our sound, regardless of where they come from, because there's always this connection. And when you go on YouTube video, you watch YouTube videos of dance, choreography to so-called African music by, you know, African children of Africans, or, you know, African Americans, wherever they come from. It's amazing how that connection becomes established. And we'll get to that as we go on in this. So now, 21st century African popular music, connecting global Africa And global Africa, I define as Africans. It's not really my definition, but I agree with this thought that Africans and people of African descent worldwide who share a common set of historical experience. And, you know, beside the genre-specific studies, contemporary African music as a compendium remains the least explored in the field of African cultural studies. There is a paucity of critical engagement on the significance of 21st century African music in particular as a connecting note to global Africa. And by global Africa, I am referring to Africans and people of African descent worldwide. Attention has not been paid to how it naturalizes the proliferation of vernacular and vehicular languages on and off the African continent. The impact of these new sounds is evident in the cultural capital they wield in deterritorializing spaces for regional, continental, and diasporic networks. Among Africans, the Black diaspora, and by extension, a more global audience. While this idea of deterritorialization is not new, it's not a new occurrence in the growth and history of African music. What is different is the speed at which it occurs and a broader reach, which makes it no longer fit into the specialty or novelty songs categories. And I'll get to that a bit. So let me talk a little bit about my title. It has two trajectories that I'll be exploring. First, sounds from the other side is indicative of the itinerant subjectivity of sounds across spaces boundaries to mark the notion of disenclosure, that is the proliferation of sound in breaking down linguistic, cultural, national fences, enclosures, linking people from the other side, close to this side, and depending on which side you're on, because it's not always like something that flows one way, it's bi-directional. Like, it flows this way and it flows that way. And as a result of that, there's this constant flow, constant exchange of ideas, of training ears to sound. So, this could also mean bridging the continental diasporic and the diaspora through sounds. This part of the title itself is not my original idea, as you would see in the first slide. It is an actual title of Ayodeji Ibrahim Balogun, aka Wizkid's third studio album, which he jointly released on his Starboy Entertainment label, the American record label RCA, and Sony Entertainment in 2017. So that album actually is like was produced for his own record label and for two other major international record labels. And the album has Nigerian, South African, and American producers on it. It featured prominent American artists such as Drake, Chris Brown, Ty Dolla $ign, Trey Songz, and South African Boosie and Ghanaian Effia, and Jamaican-American music trio, Major Lazer. So you begin to see like this thing going on there. While the presentation is not about this album or this artist, this ground clearing is critical to the second part of the presentation, African popular music in the age of technoculture. This section puts spotlight on the mechanism of production, circulation, and reception. It looks at the impact of technocultural corporatism on music as a product and its affordances that subversively locate difference in the sameness of the music that obtains in global popular culture of the entertainment industry. I connect these various ways, these ideas manifest through Afropolitanism's tripartite attribute that I mentioned earlier, fluidity, access, and network. So now I want to step back a little bit and discuss Afropolitanism and the politics of disenclosure. And basically, according to Evernote Sen and Uluradek, the project of Afropolitanism includes one, correction of misrepresentation of Africa as modernity's silent and incapacitated victim, to the joining of the continent and African diasporic communities through a punctuation of the traditional modernity divide that has kept local and global Africa as relatable separate categories in cultural discourse. And three, the mental deframing of what it means to be Africa in a global age. So these are like strands that are like connected in a way and that resonate together in how, you know, I frame, you know, the politics of, you know, breaking boundaries. That's basically disenclosure, you know, when you enclose something and somebody, you know, kind of like removes the fence so that there's this move, even though we still have this remorseless regime of visa and, you know, boundary. I mean, in some part of the world, somebody is trying to build a wall, you know, to like prevent people from coming over. But, you know, that is basically impossible to do because people move regardless of barriers that governments and, you know, the states and national sovereignty tries to enforce, because it's been the history of humanity that people move from one space to the other, even in the most constraining circumstances. We have people crossing the Mediterranean Sea and all, but I digress. The point here is that, you know, when you think about this politics of disenclosure that Afropolitanism pushes, and the way it's been resisted also is because of that, like, oh, you want to tell us that, you know, there's nothing really super different in Africa than, you know, like all those kind of argument. But they are important, but also they are essentialist because they reduce, you know, the complexity of Africa as a continent and even as a geographical space that contains, you know, humanity into one spectrum that has been trained to be seen. So disenclosure is, as Mbembe tries to explain it, a social, ethical, and political enterprise where strangeness and foreignness become the very conditions for the possibility of universality. I mean, this is like, these are big words, but the basic thing there is that, you know, just breaking all those barriers like I've explained. So how does this come to music? Kofi Agawu, in representing African music, says an ideology of difference must be replaced by an ideology of sameness, so that, and this is somewhat paradoxical, what we can gain, so that we can gain a better view of difference. You know, you can understand difference better in thinking about sameness. I mean, that's the paradox of this statement. In other words, if we proceed from a premise of sameness and grant difference in the unique expression of that sameness, we are likely to get at the true similarities and differences between musics. You know, this particular Agawu's frame for disenclosure suggests sameness as a starting point for reading African music. And Agawu's book actually responds to, you know, this notion, because Agawu is a musicologist, I'm not, but I have done, you know, research and read, you know, some of these ethnomusicologists and all of that. The way we want to, you know, all these ethnomusicologists want to read African music and try to distinguish it from like classical music, the Bach and Beethoven, and, you know, whatever, all those other, you know, great, you know, musical compositions. And then there's always this idea to essentialize what you cannot understand because it doesn't fit into their, you know, modes of thinking about sound. So Agawu is saying, like, the first place to start is to think about what's similar. Yeah, like what's the similarity that we can find, and from there we can begin to unpack why, you know, there this difference occurs in the sound. So it questions the assumption and the place of African music as text, historical archive, language, and its resonance in scholarship and lived experience of cultures that produce it. Agawu's project resonates with the post 2000 Afropolitan music, as I will call it, regarding the paradigm shift in emphasis on sameness as what drives its production, circulation, and reception. Now, to start making all these arguments, we have to, you know, revert back, go back in history and think about, you know, African popular music. What changed since the 2000s? You know, because I can just make some claims and someone will be like, but this is not new. We've always had this kind of development. So what's so special about it? I mean, generally, there's nothing new under the sun. So I need to put that out there. But also, I mean, it's like saying that leggings is a new invention. People have been wearing leggings for years, but there have been ways by which it comes back. You know, fashion has a way of coming back and rebranded. And so that is what we are seeing in this. So basically, in thinking about the post-2000 African popular music, I just need to put this out there before I go into reading so you can follow through. Policies to promote local content in different parts of the continent changed, especially like in the late 90s and thereabouts, particularly in Nigeria. You know, licenses and all of that, and all of these ideas, I'm still going to repeat them and to contextualize them. So in thinking about the post-2000 African popular music, an ideal starting point would be to briefly acknowledge precedents for insight into what is different and what has remained the same. Scholars who have read the trend of music production, particularly popular African music, often identify the hybrid nature of urban popular sound and its connections to several genres, notably global Black music cultures. And this is, you know, reading Stapleton and May, Arenas and Chari. In these discussions, assessing the sound usually runs into the problematic of global spread and the constraints of acceptance in Euro-America. You know, it's always beholden to, you know, Euro-America as, you know, where the bar is kind of like set. And from the 1950s through the 80s, a handful of African artists have found some huge but limited breakthrough in the global entertainment scene. For the most part, they find more success in the specialist music category known as world music, which denotes non-European and non-American music. It became a market category for selling records from the African continent and elsewhere to the diaspora and Western audiences interested in collecting ethnic, exotic sounds. So the era of world music internationalized a lot of African sound, but with modest success. The first US Grammy category for world music was in 1991. It brings all kinds of music from traditional music to variations of sound heavily influenced by American and European styles into this category. In 2003, the division was split into contemporary and traditional to recognize the shift in trends. Today, this Grammy Award remains one of the most significant achievement awards for a non-Western artist, even with everything associated with that category. Eric Chari notes in Hip Hop Africa that, quote, in the half century since the first African musical artist gained international fame in the Northern Hemisphere, that is South African Maria Makeba, only a handful of Africans have broken through the barrier that surrounds the continent when it comes to high profile musical exports. Meanwhile, on the other end of the African continent, particularly from the 80s through the mid 90s, Western pop music dominated the airwaves alongside continentally popular but internationally marginal pop music like Nigeria's Juju and Fuji music, Ghana's High Life and its variants, Hip Life, Congo's Sukus, Cameroonian Makosa, Zimbabwe's Jit, Zambia's Zamrock, South Africa's Mbakanga, I don't know if I'm pronouncing it well, I'm butchering it, Cote d'Ivoire's Coupe de Calais, and the rest of them. What is fascinating in this global flow of sonic materiality of Western music is that a lot of the exports are considered Black music, from blues, funk, jazz, bebop, rhythm and blues to rap. These sounds have to them the influence of African percussive elements, And that makes them legible to listeners, mostly the youth. Though they are Euro-American music, they are mostly received as global African sounds. So you see the paradox playing out that Agao talks about. You know, when you pick up any of these genres and you play it, because there's also a variant of them also on the continent, like South African jazz, you know, you have house music, you have all these other variants going on. So they are still like Black music, regardless of who is singing them, whether the person's racial category is not Black or what or it is, there's that element that resonates with people on the continent. Their reception and influence are also apparent in the locally produced music with the co-optation of style, instrumentation, and studio production technique. And so it is not hard to see how artists on the continent gravitate towards catering to their audience with the use of predominantly Western technology, such as synth drums and synthesized bass and drums, horns and guitars, in addition to other instruments that define the local genre. So you find all this kind of instrumentation in what is considered traditional ethnic sound, as you know, the same instrumentation that so-called Western music use in producing. So Arenas in his account notes that the rise of Bob Marley in internationalizing reggae and the experimentation with kora and balafon instrument, which launched the careers of Mori Kante and Salif Keita, are noteworthy in this trend. The issue in this exchange, however, as it relates to exports from Africa, is the cultural imperialism that marked world music as a marketing category and under for African popular music. Fernando Arenas in Lusophone Africa argues that the myriad of musical styles that comprises the universe of world music category are steeped in racialized adjectives like authentic, exotic, other, which play as a massive part in their commercialization. Arenas notes that this idea is problematic. It points to the sounds being, quote, ideologically overdetermined, given the fact that the field of music in question is essentially Eurocentric, or even more specifically, Anglocentric phenomenon in its inception, which is inevitably caught in the historical and geopolitical web of postcolonialism. What is instructive about Eric Chari and Fernando Arenas' claims are the limitations and the burden the African artists and their art have to carry at the time is that the sense of almost but not quite Western, that sense of almost Western but not quite Western, in spite of shared history, stylistic elements, creolized nature, of the sonic properties of those African's music, they have been condemned to affirm certain conceptions that undermine their coeval relationship with music anywhere else. Also, the artists that came after Maria Makeba, Hugh Masekela, and Hugh Masekela, like Yusuf Ndo, Sonny Ade, and others, even with their crossover music, which fused electro and funk, still could not break through that ceiling with their success in the diaspora and on the continent. So for a long time, the binaristic paradigm of dependency theory from the realms of economics and geopolitics into the cultural fields play out and marks the world music critique on how African popular music has been studied, understood, and received. The post-2000 modern African popular music reconfigures some of these concerns, even though they are still with us in different forms, and I'll get to that later. One major shift that we begin to see came in policies across different countries on the continent to promote local content, as you can see on your screen. For instance, through the late 90s in Nigeria, More licenses were issued for private radio and TV stations alongside the laws to promote local artists. So while Euro-American music still enjoys popularity, the local artists also became more visible. And new entertainment channels, you know, you have Channel O and so many of those other cable channels, MTV Base and all those ones. I mean, a lot of them started catering to music produced in Africa. So labels were springing up, magazines and newspaper columns on local hip-hop were becoming popular. And in Nigeria, Kenny's Music, for example, Kenny's Music was one of the key players that promoted music groups like the Plantation Boys, the Remedies, and solo artists like Innocent Idibia, Two-Face, or Tubaba, as people call him, who came to international renown in 2004, actually, with his single, African Queen, from the Face to Face album. Some artists like Sheisho Dimo and Pretty and Young and several others put out music without the backing of record labels. And also, diasporic artists like Oladapo Ibanjo Dibanj and Collins Ajeri Don Jazzy in 2004 started their own record label, Moitz Record, which became one of the biggest and most successful Nigerian record labels. They built their brand around their multiple subjectivities because these guys were living in London. And then fusing various influences to aesthetically make music and create a persona that exudes what Tai Selassie in essay Bye Bye Baba termed the Afropolitan sensibility. This artist and many others influenced profoundly the new wave of African popular music, which is often referred to as Afrobeats, with the emphasis on the S. The trend happening in Nigeria saw artists getting more airplay and national, regional, and international recognition. It became a music movement that spread all over the continent, and the global Black diaspora was responding to it. So this is not just happening in Africa, in Nigeria specifically. It's happening in different parts of the continent, but also because Nigeria is huge in this regard. There's a transference of Nigerian sound because Nigeria is arguably the most populous African country, and you have Nigerians everywhere. And these sounds are also taken all over the place. And these sounds also started influencing some other sounds that were already at play in different parts of the continent, and also, most importantly, outside the continent. So I just want to also, now you have an extroverted Africa based on this thing, you know, the vernacularization that takes alienation to the extreme. Like what is seen to be un-African now is being promoted as something that is actually essentially African when you begin to see how it plays out, because Africa is not just one thing. Africa is many things. So yeah, you know, there's this controversy over what should we call these sounds that are proliferating the airwaves all over. Is it Afrobeat? Is it Afrobeats? Is it Afropolitan vibes? And what exactly is in naming the sound? And what does this really mean to name it? So for me, I think about it, you know, based on what I've been laying down in terms of how Afropolitanism and what it discloses and how it brings together, you know, finding sameness in difference and difference in sameness and all of those things. Like, it's hard because Afrobeats did not even originate from the African cultural producers themselves. It started like in the UK because people are listening to these sounds, they are grooving to it, and they're like, oh, this is Afrobeats. This is like something related to African beats. You know, there's something different about this. So basically, I try to call it Afropolitan vibe or Afro vibe, if you will, because of the way it engages the global techno-capitalist structure for self-assertion. As Africans of the world, it's not just Africa in terms of some native tribal stuff going on. It's the native tribal stuff going on and a lot of other things, you know, coming together to redefine the idea of even the native. Like, what do you even mean when you say somebody's an African? Where do you even start? How do you even define? When you say an African, what do you think about? What makes you define them? Is it just the language they speak? Yes, they speak a particular language, but they also speak other languages. I mean, what exactly makes them African? You know, and so we begin to think about the vernacularization of dominant cultural ideologies, you know, from influence in the visual representation of Blackness, you know, from hip-hop and all of those things, to actually the tapestry of, you know, Africa generally in modernity, and connecting it with the diasporic identity outside the cultural, outside cultural nativism, you know, this notion that is very popular in thinking about, oh, you know, you are not African enough. And when people say things like that, I'm always wondering, what do they mean by not African enough? What idea of Africa are they imposing or superimposing on somebody? How are you defining an African? I mean, you know, because there's no archetypal African. You can only define it based on, and that's why I'm very careful not to say, oh, in Africa we do this, or in Africa we sing like this, because how much of Africa do I know? And that is a place to start interrogating some of these absolutist claim on how many cultures, how many African languages do I speak? Or how much of the nuances of, you know, environments do I really know to stake a claim to, you know, African this, African that, you know. So these guys are breaking outside of that. So, and in thinking about the idea of the Afropolitan vibe, there's a distorting effect in the evolution of these musics, circumscribing their sonic spectrum. The delicate balance of producing the music in the context is not based on some nativist drive necessarily marked as different from what obtains elsewhere in the world. Instead of creating another ecosystem for their artistry, the artists, the new generation of artists engage the global techno-capitalist structure, a different form of corporatism, to assert themselves as what Tai Selassie calls Africans of the world. In East African hip-hop, Mwenda Ntarangwi explains their process from the purview of vernacularization. Ntarawangi identifies the advantageous schooling a lot of young African musicians have had in combining different influences to produce a vernacularization of dominant cultural ideologies, you know, from their culture and other cultures that influence their artistry. It enables them to easily travel through and inhabit different cultural spaces that reproduce in them a certain hybridity that is difficult to tie to a specific locale or ethnicity. Ntarangwi's idea underscores the notion of Afropolitan worldliness, which emanates from a globally oriented fixation on taking alienation to the extreme for building a complicated interwoven world that is informed by history, itinerancy, and a complex, you know, tapestry of Africa. So, and if we think of this along what Sarah Nuttall and Bembe tried to do with defining worldliness, they foresee that they connect with this Afropolitan sensibility of worldliness on the ability to foreground, translate, fragment, and disrupt realities and imaginaries originating elsewhere. And in the process, place these forms and processes in the service of one's own making. It's like, you know, taking something strange and making it familiar. Recreating stuff in a way that you take out the foreignness and you make it yours, you own it. I mean, like, you know, I'm not talking about this in terms of cultural appropriation, because that is another topic entirely that most people think like, oh, they're appropriating our culture. And because we live in a world that is more linked, there's this fluidity of ideas, of cultural nuances that gets transferred unintentionally sometimes. This assertion corroborates Agabu's argument on ideology of sameness for reading African music. The notion of world making is indeed the defining factor for the Afropolitan music in the post-colonial present. Likewise, Afropolitan artists in the diaspora connect with this idea of worldliness, which emanates from the visibility of African music and its diasporic bind to their transnational being and belonging. Usually before, you know, like the 2000s, like I talked to a lot of kids who grew up here, whose parents were African, like older guys, also in the UK, and there's this thing about not being, it wasn't cool to say, oh, I'm an African, you know, because there are all these stereotypes, racial, racist stereotypes about being African. It's cool to say I'm Caribbean in the UK, like I'm Jamaican and all of that, because reggae, because, you know, Caribbeans have a way of flow, a way of, you know, doing things that. But then that has changed over time. And now it's cool to speak African languages in all the spaces, and you are not ashamed that somebody will look at you like you just dropped from the sky. So to this point, Nsia Clark, writing on the question of identity of the African diaspora in America specifically, says this, and I quote, "What is interesting about this group is that they can and do claim either identity or both simultaneously. Legally, they are African Americans, but in reality, they are neither fully African nor fully African American. I mean, I still have a problem with that. At different times, and depending on the context, they may be considered members of both African and African American communities. Depending on their upbringing, they are often just as comfortable in an all-African as in an all-American, all-African-American environment. The ambivalence of their position can thus be appreciated." And these are also people who produce culture out of the sounds that come across them on the internet. And you see all these kids who are doing, who have created a dance studio, and they record their moves and all of that, and they share it. And even like, you know, on Instagram, because they follow all these celebrities, and those guys will be like, oh, this is the new cool dance movement. Send your video doing this dance. And you see all of that going on and the way it's spreading, and they are proud to go in public and do this dance and record it and share it to the world. So what Nsia Clark signals is particularly significant, showing how the younger generation of African descent embraces and takes alienation to the extreme without a sense of irony, of being lost in transnation, of being part of this different world, of embodying all sorts of identities without contradiction. So as Clark foregrounds, there's a way of existence that is not caught up in the cultural anxiety of the older generation. And of Africans in the diaspora, you know, this longing for home, this, you know, like the exiles and those people who are taking, you know, like these kids have grown up in this environment, and even within this environment, there's an ecosystem that has been created in which they connect with what happens at home, even though some people on the continent will not consider them, you know, African enough, you know, but also there are people on the continent who would not even come across as African enough anyway, because of this, so much of the world in Africa and so much of Africa in the world. So it suggests a different kind of wording that speaks to the preponderance of an Afropolitan aesthetic visible in the works of many African diasporic artists. Artists like Jidenna in the US, Wale in the US, Rihanna, you know, the element of the Caribbean and the African in the influencing our sound, Wyclef Jean in the US, Shoaib Malik Berry, Michael Ward Jr. Stormzy in the UK, Stephanie Allen, Steph London, who's like Caribbean, African, and English, Joseph Adenuga Jr. Skepta in the UK, Eli Yafa, Buba, and Mohamed Sila, MDH in France, Cape Verdean Mara Andrade in Portugal. Portugal to the Somali, Norwegian, Scandinavian star Shirihan Abdul Sherry in Sweden, and Pedro Lisboa Santos, Quatro Pedro, C4 Pedro in Angola, David Adeleke Davido, Tiwatope Savage, and Aziz Fashola Nairamali in Nigeria, because these guys were actually born and raised in outside of the country, and they are the forefront of the so-called African music now, in their different capacity, and how the Fonseca, Jay Something, the other guy in the Mikasa group in South Africa, and numerous other artists like them plug into the currents of their multiple subjectivities across cultures and in several musical influences that inform their artistry. One of the vital global flows in the music of these artists has been a movement towards what could be considered the new frontier of African music. The preceding underscores Afropolitan music, continental and diasporic, as a diverse, there's a diverse configuration of existential project in a world embedded and emergent from an increasingly urban space. So, and here is where we can read fluidity and access and network in the sense of how, you know, they are not only adapting to the changing vibe of what African and Africanness mean in terms of their existence, but also in terms of what they listen to, what they gravitate towards, and how they define culture in these spaces, but also how that happens even on the continent. And so you have that plasticity, that ability to like mesh things together, and the access to the global commons via the internet makes it possible, creates a lot of affordances to also create this community that is not domiciled in a particular geographical space. So you belong, I mean, when you watch YouTube videos, one of those things that I would want you to do more is read comments. And because it's fascinating, you know, somebody will say, oh, from Somalia, I love South African house music. Oh, I live in England, but I love my African people. You know, like, and there'll be somebody who'll be like, you know, I don't understand what this guy is saying in this song. I vibe with it. And somebody else will volunteer to put the lyrics there so that the person can see and even interpret what the person is saying in that language. So there's a network of sociality that is created around sounds because of these platforms and what they afford. Like, you know, there's the comment section. And beyond all of this, I mean, while acknowledging the arbitrariness of naming a body of vast repertoire of creative musical outputs in this period, it is necessary to properly account for and categorize this new frontier of African music to engage with how they circulate critically. As Agawo underscores, the problem of ontologizing African music under a unified cultural phenomenon, and his argument suggests why Afrovibe may be the right fit for capturing the post-2000 African music scape. He notes, quote, the continued use of the phrase African music when one's authority is an African village, town, or region reproduces the metonymic fallacy, the part representing the whole, faced by most writers on Africa. While Nigerian music is African music is more than Nigerian music, end quote. And you would remember that I tried to, you know, build this nuanced way of talking about it. Like, you know, even though I will be drawing like examples from South Africa, from Angola, from Kenya, from different parts, that does not specifically mean that because I talked about Nigerian development of this sound in Nigeria, not as a representative whole for the rest of the continent. And in trying to pass this way that there's diversity and all of that, is to pay attention that you can't actually name one thing and use one thing to name everything. So it is for the same reason that I mentioned the time Afropolitan music, because it can any sound can fit into that categorization based on the parameters that I've offered earlier. So as a fitting pointer to the diversity of the music that constitutes the analysis in my work. So I mean, like on the debate of Afrobeats and all of that, different artists on the continent actually come out to say, you know, my sound is not Afrobeats, it is this. And while Afrobeat is a distinct genre, it's been a very significant influence. Afrobeat without the S, the one created by Fela Nicola Pokuti. Afrobeat is a distinct genre, while Afrovibe is a more capacious, inclusive way of that shows the cross-pollination of ideas, mixing, refining, and bending different genres that carry the sensibility of the global popular culture, which influences them. While there are contemporary artists like Wizkid and Burna Boy and several others, even the rappers like AK and all those guys, who draw inspiration from sampling Afrobeat and Fela's extraordinary supersonic, extrasonic, larger than life persona, the music they produce and how they make it is fundamentally different. It is diverse in formulaic, rhythmic pattern, conceptual framework, themes, and polyvocality. And for instance, Burna Boy in an interview says this, and I quote, "Afrobeat is Fela Kuti. Afrobeats is just what people in, I think, must have been in the UK, just decided to call African music or Nigerian music. Yeah, African music, because they didn't know what to call it. They just want to give it a name. They heard Afrobeat from Fela and they thought, oh, let us do Afrobeats. You understand, like the umbrella for Afropop, Afro this and that, you know? And Afrofusion is like the rebel, because Burna Boy defines his own sound as Afrofusion, which is a blend of everything. So, and there's another artist who calls his sound Afro Soul, although there are also, you know, specific genres that we can talk about, you know, like which could come under the umbrella of Afropolitan sounds, basically. So, because Afrobeat is essentially political, as Olaniyan position is a quintessentially political genre. And there are people who still do Afrobeat in its purest sense, like Seun Kuti, the late Tony Allen, and many others who have Femi Kuti, and many others who are like committed to that particular, the quintessence of that genre. But if we think about some of the sounds that have been produced, some of them are not even named yet. You know, you can take the multiplicity of blended form sounds and rhythm. It could be mixed and distinct from dancehall, Afrofusion, hip-hop, house, rock, jazz, reggae, reggaeton, raga, salsa, pop, trap, bakoso, Afrobeat, Afrikalypso, bongo flava, Fuji, juju grime, what we call Lamba, otherwise known as urban slum music. And this Bankula is a mixture of R&B, highlife, and measured synth. Bashment and the African electronic dance music, such as Kwom and Kwaito in South Africa, Wobe and Zanku sound in Nigeria, to name a few. So it is worth noting, however, that Afropolitan music seems to connect with Afrobeat. In principle, at the level of what Tejimola Olaniyan in Arrest Music, the rebel out of Fela, Anikulako calls the unique cosmopolitan nativism. It's cosmopolitan, but there's an element of the native there. So according to Olaniyan, Fela's cosmopolitanism is not an atavistic return to roots, but a reclaiming of authentic subjectivity, a subjectivity that expresses itself freely without the element of a crudely obvious compulsion, the power and autonomy of Africa to direct itself and its place in the world. So Fela creates his own persona, creates this idea of African that is not strange to, you know, Western music. I mean, when you look at Fela's composure, like the band, the horn, the arrangement, and the kind of heavy percussive elements and all of that. It's just this freely created sound that is distinct in and of itself, but that is not beholden to trying to be essentialist or not beholden to, you know, Western paradigm of how sound works. So in this regard, Afro-Polynesian music subversively avoids and often rejects being defined by totalizing cultural formation that's marked by difference. So musicians assert contemporariness of their oeuvre by disrupting it, you know, to maintain the unique authenticity and Africanness of their sounds and artistry from what obtains elsewhere. And I'll get to that soon. You know, people would, if you go on like streaming apps and you see how most of these songs are categorized, that will give you an idea of how, you know, there's this constant effort to redefine, you know, this sound. Maybe like on Apple Music, you see maybe a Burna Boy song as worldwide, or Kaspar Yuva's song as, you know, worldwide, and whatever that means. And it's like they stop short of saying world music because it's not world music, and it's different. While local Caribbean and European American tunes are influenced by and also influence some of the Afro-Polynesian musicians, the artists usually produce a unique sound that familiarizes non-rhythms and genres to develop something else that is neither indigenous nor foreign. So that is the balance. It's neither indigenous nor foreign. The middle ground complicates this binaristic argument about world music mentioned earlier. So the musicians assert the contemporariness of their oeuvre by fitting into the global popular cultural flows, while simultaneously disrupting it to maintain their unique Africanness. So this delicate balance and complexity are quite significant in framing Afro-Polytanism in real time. By real time, I mean the real, tangible, non-utopic presentness of music in lived experience and how it creates a global commons, and which, according to Amy Elias, I quote, nothing belongs to anyone, yet everything belongs to everyone, end quote. This idea is apparent in their cultural influence in Euro-America, given the massive following of the continental and diasporic Africans, which enabled the artists to, you know, generate significant revenue from online streaming, downloads, ringtones, pop-up merchandise store, sales, endorsement deals, and sold-out concerts. And these are like known facts, you know, someone like Wizkid booking O2 Arena and so selling out. You know, all these guys are doing like big things. They no longer have to play at festivals like it used to be for all these big African artists, that, you know, the way they connect with a huge crowd is for them to be invited to all these European festivals and all those other places. So, and, you know, we've also had, you know, people like Maria Makeba selling out is a big stadium. I mean, those are like the breakouts from the bunch. But now this is commonplace that, you know, they go everywhere. Beyond the cultural influence and the financial reward that accrue to these artists, the Afro-Polytanism vibe itself is shaping the soundscape of its old and new diaspora. This is may occur in parodies, in new dance movements, sampling of beats, a complete mutation of sound into something entirely novel in the different contexts. So this quote that has been showing on this screen for a long time is actually like something that I came about in trying to see how this sound circulates. And this is coming from Cuba. And we all know that politically, Cuba is kind of like shut out from the world, as it were. You know, there's limited access to you know, modern day technology as such. And still, African sound found a way to Cuba and then recreates a particular genre in Cuba. And this quote actually, it shows the example of a transboundary influence beyond the restriction of government and all of that. So because this African sounds of, you know, the Angolan sound, the Kizomba, and all those other musical genres, you know, the New Age, Makossa, and all of that, found their way into Cuba because there were African students in Cuba who went there to study medicine, because medicine is actually huge in Cuba. And so you have all these African students going to Cuba, and then they take all these their songs on flash drives to Cuba, and then they introduce these sounds to people. And from there, there's a whole new movement that was created out of that, and that is Bakoso, which is a new genre of music coming out of Santiago de Cuba, influenced by the sounds of Africa that I just mentioned. So we have, you know, one of the practitioners of the sound making a comment here that we've already had the story of African influence in Cuba and in the Caribbean. And usually when it's referred, it's talked about through the transatlantic slave trade. And that's understandable because so much of the exchange happened at that time. But it can feel like it's kind of stopped there, and there's still the need. There's still the new influence that's happening today. So I think Bakoso is a beautiful way to highlight that we are not just talking about an old connection to Africa. We are talking about something that's very current and something that's new. We are still connected. Africa isn't a thing of the past, still creating new sounds. And the culture is still being infused into Cuban and other cultures today. And, you know, when you think about that, you also think about why these sounds are, these artists on the continent are so big, and they have become big enough to capture the global music market as well. You know, you now have Universal Music Group setting up shop in Lagos and in other parts of the continent where the music is really booming. And some of them also tapping all these artists to put them on their label. But what you see is that some of these artists who are already big, like Wizkid and, you know, all these other guys, what they do is they do album contracts. You know, like they do contracts on album, but they refuse to be sold to those labels. So they still own their own record labels, and they own the stems, you know, the original copy to their song, so they can claim the full rights and the full ownership and, you know, whatever revenue accrues to that. And that is what you see playing out in a lot with a lot of these guys. So that was how Sound from the Other Side came by. And that's why it's on Wizkid's Starboy label, RCA label, and Sony Entertainment label. And you apart from this assertion of autonomy, you also see that now when they collaborate with artists in the US or in the UK or elsewhere, they are not being helped by these guys. Rather, it's like a collaboration of equals. Even though some of these guys here may be more famous in this place, but they also need to enter the African market, which is now where the new sounds are happening. So I'll take an instance with Wizkid's Come Closer. I mean, I've been talking a lot, so I think we should do some music so that I can catch my breath. You know, in this collaboration with Drake, the song went had a lot of hits globally. It peaked at 15, number 15 Netherlands single tip, 28 on R&B hip hop hair play, and 38 on rhythmic in the US Billboard, 58 on the UK singles, and 54 on Canada Hot 100, 107 on France's Snap. You know, like, all across the world, this particular song was doing so great. I mean, as it has like close to 90 million views on YouTube now, this particular song. And that is aside downloads and streaming and, you know, different ways by which the song has circulated in clubs. Thank God for DJs, because they are like a pivotal part, as I would talk about later. So yes, Come Closer.
Go outside. Big time forward. The Starboy dancer. Coming to the game, the one replace me. Me love my energy, strength, me don't chase her. All of my guys know me all about me paper. Me call me girls all around me, me don't chase her. Yeah, Starboy call me number one. When me tune drop, the girls they bounce along. Me don't let nothing come between me and me paper. So when me come in, I'll
Quickly, because I said Afropolitan aesthetics, roots and routes. This scene of choreographed dancing could be anywhere in the world. This could be New York, this could be happening in a South African club, this could be in Lagos, this could be anywhere else. And also you see the incorporation of this notion of the aesthetics of Africanness, like when you think about the fabric, background and the artist wearing it, but also there's something that is not really African about that. And, you know, even like the way he dresses and the kind of designers and all of those things he wears is the same thing you would see a Drake, if Drake were to be in this video, wearing and also embodying. So, and this is just African people from all over the world in with different historical connection vibing to these particular beats that, well, you call this African beats or American beats or, but there's something in it that there's that baseline in it that also says something about, you know, certain kind of musical musicality that's predominant in some of our traditional music, but also there are all that layers and layers on it that is as American, as European as it can be. So that is to say that there's this meshing, there's this way where, you know, to distinctly sift out some of these things, and when you hear this song go up anywhere in the world, anybody can dance without even knowing what this guy is saying or where it comes from or what it looks like, because that is sound. And that takes us to this next video, which is from Beyonce's latest project in 2019 for Lion King, the album, which she calls The Gift. The Gift had like African artists on them, or on almost all the songs, but also even where she sings, there's a way that she infuses elements of the new phase of African sound, or what people call African sound, into our artistry. But here you have Beyoncé Shatawale from Ghana and Major Lazer, the Jamaican American trio, who are producers and singers as well. And this one is called Already. And I don't want to talk about the themes here, but I'm just going to talk briefly after we are done enjoying it.
Who are you? I know exactly who I am. The question is, who are you?
I'm nobody, so leave me alone, all right?
Everybody is somebody. Even a nobody.
Yeah, I think you're confused.
I am confused? You don't even know who you are.
Oh, and I suppose you do.
Follow me. I will show you.
Everything you know it. King already, you know it. My body, soul, but a king body. Body gon' shine, big, big body. Calling all the shots, ring, ring body. Crown on your head, got a king body. Deliver the key, you a king, you know it. King already, my baby, you know it. Top everything, everything, you know it. King already, you know it. Shine already, it's time already. Align already, it's time already. Shine already, it's time already. Line already, it's time already.
Charlie, stop it, just say no, no, no. Where I'm kissing, don't you know, no, no. Charlie, stop it, just say go, 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 go. I'm a lap, I watch it go, 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 go. Me ruler, me ruler, yeah. Every warrior, they conquer, yeah. Every king, be stronger, yeah. King, they rule them longer, yeah. Remember who you are, real king, always be no.
Shine your body, shine your body. Long live the king, you know it. King already, you know it. Top everything, everything, you know it. King already, you know it. My body's all got a king body. Body gon' shine, big, big body. Calling all the shots, ring, ring body. Crown on your head, got a king body. Long live the king, you a king, you know it. King already, my baby, you know it. Top everything, everything, you know it. King already, you know it. Shine already, time already. Shine already, time already. Shine already, time already. Shine already, time already.
All right, there's been a lot of talk about this particular video, but what I find fascinating in this is not just the sound, it's not just the to see Beyoncé, you know, singing on this sound, but also the message it carries. That first intro, that conversation is from this American movie Roots, you know, about slavery, the Kinta Kunte, you know, and also it's bringing in this idea of, you know, the old diaspora, the Africans who have lost that connection, to know who they are, to know that they are kings already, to know that they come from a history that is richer. And that is why, I mean, some people will say, oh, why is she using all this animal skin and all of that? I mean, these are references to deep history, deep time history, like where we came from, you know, like this civilization exists. And you will see like different airlines and different aesthetic designs that actually have more historical significance that even like some Africans who are commenting on it, who are like saying, you know, this is not Africa. It's because also, you know, there's a disconnect. But also in a way that she presents it is such that it is not essentializing or trying to, you know, paint this thing as savage, but also bringing it into the modern time to say like, this is modernity in and of itself. And Africa has always been modern. And you will see different cuts, you know, one from this Nigerian meat market and one on the Ghanaian street and one in New York where she's on a bike, and then mashing all these different kind of visual scape together produces this kind of aesthetic connection of roots and to different routes that, you know, Africans have dispersed, you know, and also bringing the history of the past into the present and connecting it in a way to tell people that, you know, if you are bogged down by racism and all of this, know that you're already a king. And that's like the whole idea of the album. All right. I kind of like skipped because I see that I've really run I mean, time-wise. I didn't know that time has really gone like that, but I'll speed things up and we'll get there. So to the other section, which is technoculture, making the world an Afropolitan office, Renee Lisa Van Gay defines technoculture as communities and forms of cultural practices that have emerged in response to changing media and information technologies, forms characterized by technological adaptation and avoidance, subversion and resistance. So Afropolitan music participates in the technocultural shift, and like there's a movement from, you know, the locomotive machines that produce sounds and visual images, emblematic of the kinetic and motive power, to machines that, like the computer, whose outer shell has no emblematic power. In essence, African music production and circulation in the 21st century does not necessarily require a full band or, you know, heavy equipment. The so-called African beats produced, you know, with minimal technology available, and as Karen Baba rightly observes in the history of popular culture, we are in a new regime of information age. The small scale personal technology gave access to a huge amorphous transnational domain of the internet, which no national entity has succeeded in controlling anywhere in the world. And the reason these so-called African musicians and their sounds traveling is because also that gatekeeping power that, you know, Western record labels used to have on African artists is no longer there, because, you know, you can just put anything on SoundCloud, put your song on YouTube and see how it goes. And there's this new regime of information sharing that has kind of like broken that those boundaries and that ecosystem, and making the world available to you, even from your shack somewhere, in a different part of the world. You know, could be in Costa Rica and you are reaching a massive audience in the UK. And so now you have the whole world on your palms with your phone. You can record your voice and send it to an artist in America, and they will record their voice, and then you guys will put it on a beat. And that's a collaboration, and you don't even have to meet and see each other. So we see all of this happening in real time. And, you know, we've moved from the age of CDs to, you know, online streaming and MP3, you know. All of this technology has, this documentary, The Future of Sound, The Future Sound of Mzansi, I mean, I think that's South Africa, Spike Matambo's documentary, it talks about how, you know, music go viral, the idea of viral sound, and which is, you know, you share it and you have people gravitating towards it. And this, like, you know, you now have SoundCloud, iTunes, you know, and all these other Google Play, all these other platforms to sell your music, without necessarily having to go to a specific record label to help you promote your song. And you might, some of these songs would catch. I mean, in the interview, there's this story of these guys who produced a beat in Durban, you know, Durban, Kwaito. And those guys just did it in their basement and then put it out there. And people were bumping to it all over the city. And nobody knew who they were, like, who made this really good sound. And DJs would just put it on repeat because people are dancing to it. And that's the regime of information that we now have going on. So also a significant aspect of this is the advent of the African DJs, like not only on the continent, but in the diaspora. And now you have like clubs who are like committed to actually, you see, African night, Caribbean night, you know, Afro something, something. And it's all over the place, any big city you go, because there's a huge diaspora in all these centers all over the world. you find that there's always that space that is there for African music. So, and that also helps to spread the sound in an interesting way. So the Beyoncé's and all these Drake's and all those other artists, from the older diaspora and the new ones like Jidenna, Nawali and all those guys, did not happen to by chance on these sounds. These sounds have already spread in a way that they have to buy into it. And so, because that is what techno-capitalism has created, an extended network of global communities of consumers, fans, and social media. I mean, social media is where all these artists, you know, they, some of them we have 2 billion fans, 2 million fans, and, you know, from there, they self-promote their songs. They self-promote their songs. So that is what Luis Suarez Villa in techno-capitalism thought as what techno-capitalism offers. So in reproducing creativity, diffusing knowledge, and promoting participation. And this regime also creates support for creative agenda, collaboration, and sharing, the articulation of exchange relationships. This idea succinctly supports and reiterates my calibration of contemporary African music as an Afropolitan project. With techno-capitalist platforms, technology more than ever mediates the African music culture in lived experiences of people, regardless of boundaries, cultures, languages, and status. Consequently, you know, this new music culture finds expression in how Afropolitan discourse thinks about boundaries and participation of global Africa in modernity. Unlike older generation of African artists, the Afropolitan musician employs the virtual space as an office for self-promotion, as I've explained. In the process, you know, the ease of access to an enabling media that builds such rapport meant that participation could launch and elaborate on cultural tropes collectively through informal instant exchanges. So this notion is evident in how fans sample their songs, create dance videos and other creative appropriations before the artists release the official videos on YouTube. For example, some people will do a mashup images of the artist and, you know, with the moving mouth, but it's not the actual video. And, you know, you have some people doing like all this visualizer, which will animate, you know, the lyrics and the picture of the artist. So corporations now need the artists as brand ambassadors. So the artists leverage on these things to brand themselves. So music now becomes a product that, you know, they can actually sell without needing the middleman. Although it helps if you also have all those album collaborations with bigger labels in different parts of the world, because they can promote the sound that is already promoted by itself, but they can extend the reach to other people, a more global audience that are not gravitating towards the sound, as it were. So, you know, Dolce & Gabbana, or, you know, you had this kid on Runway with Naomi Campbell for Dolce & Gabbana. And we were Davido releasing a song for Dolce & Gabbana to raise funds to, like, you know, take care of some of these issues going on in the world at the moment. So there's a different form of corporatism going on around, you know, the African artist. And an African artist cannot be like a brand, you know. Casper Invest is also a brand ambassador for Dolce & Gabbana, as well as Wizkid and all those other bigger artists. So, you know, there's NSC Artistry, where they bring African artists together to do ciphers and all of that. And you have the Coca-Cola, Coca-Cola studio thing where they bring artists from different regions to collaborate on a particular sound. You know, these are things that are happening and also helping to extend the influence of these artists and the kind of audience that they appeal to. The multiple streams of income afford many of these artists a way out of the economy of suffering in most of their post-colonial African states. It grants them access and privilege of multiple subjectivities as they participated in the unprecedented cultural flow. So this global communication, cultural exchange and travel are a peculiar turn in which African cultural producers and creators are no longer figures caught in between, no longer creolized, much less hybridized. They now belong to an age where doubling is the condition for traveling subjectivity. Also, by doubling, I mean the politics of disenclosure to stake claims to here and there in the creative presencing of their artistry in multiple spaces. So, like, you know, when you think about this idea, that is what we call the geography, what geographers are now calling geography of mobility. The whole world is indeed on the move and has always been so. What has changed with globalization is the intensity of movement and the geographic scale over which many of those movements occur. So this scale and intensity of movement in condition of traveling subjectivities inform why Afropolitan musicians occupy a discursive space. I know this is a lot to dump in one presentation, but I think it's important to emphasize that. So I've been talking about the social historical angle and all these other things happening, and Africa as a new marketplace of new sounds. So that everybody is buying into. But now I want to turn to the soundscape itself, like what constitutes the aesthetic of it, the style, the form of the sound itself, because I think it's important to think about that as well. So soundscape describes the entire spectrum of sounds. It's a concept that generally addresses the ecology of sound, particularly as it relates to the problem of noise and the improvement of our environment. So, but scholars have also adopted it as a concept for acoustic resonance of music. So soundscape describes the entire spectrum of sound in a piece of music, what they are, the variety, their arrangements, their decibel level and pitch. So the Afropolitan sound, as I've tried to explain, is the sole creation of a music producer who arranges the beat using a digital audio workstation. And you know, like, I mean, earlier on people started with Fruity Loops and all those other basic stuff, but now it's more advanced and you have FL Studio and all those really with, you know, the DAW is a software program that the music producers use composing, recording, producing, mixing and editing audio. Producers link the software with minimal hardware component like musical instrument digital interface, they call MIDI for short, such as a keyboard and drum pads. You know, they put that there. The FL 2.0 studio software is the most popular among music producers in Nigeria, South Africa, and pretty much in most places on the continent and outside. So these gadgets provide packages and plugins that can produce sounds which are not necessarily strange or unfamiliar to the environment context of their production. So for example, music instruments like conga, shakers, which Yoruba people call shekere, bongo, gong, drums, and percussions are available in different software packets. So you don't really need to hire a drummer. You can get it from all these software packages and mash them together and produce sound. So the producers trained listening is the most important part, because they have to have a trained listening and familiarity with some musical instruments to create that Africanness or what is Afro about the peak beats that they produce. So in my actual research, I did 50 representative sample of post 2000 music track from West, East, and Central and North Africa, also South African side as well. And but also in all these other parts, the African feel is the shaker, especially in West African, East African, and Central African. The shaker is a beaded gourd. Music instrument used in a lot of the so-called traditional sound in West Africa. This particular instrument combines with e-piano keys and strings and breaks, bass lines, snares, kicks, claps, and all other sampled sounds for drums, Roland TR-808 Rhythm Composer, an electronic drum machine, feature prominently for building up the heavy drum line and the tempo. Often the producer's creativity includes the ability to make their keyboard and guitar chords, as well as beats with the drum pad that could simulate any traditional live rhythm from anywhere in the world. Also through vocoding, which is like, you know, they record, like as I'm talking, they can record my voice and reverse it and flatten it and convert it into a sound. And it will just be another layer that you'll be wondering, like this is different, but you don't know that it's not a chord, it's actually a recorded voice. So software makes all those possible to do. So the use of human voice as an element of beat making is a common practice, especially in South African electronic dance music, like Kwaito, and you know, whether it's heavy Kwaito, so, and also in all these sounds, you know, the Zanku sound and the Wobe sound in Nigeria. For example, I'm gonna give us Midnight Staring. I know that maybe the audience here is familiar with the song, and we'll just talk a little bit about the sound itself.
Hey, Dupo, sorry, just before you go on, can we just say 10 minutes and then just wrap up in 10 minutes and then we'll have some time for questions?
Excuse me?
So can we just say 10 more minutes? And then just so we have a bit of time, yeah. We've gone a bit over time. So I just want to make sure that we...
After this slide, there's one slide, I think, and then...
Okay. I'll wrap it up. Okay, no problem.
Yeah, sure. I just get carried away. Sorry. No, you can hear the beat skipping clap, bang, 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 and then you have the shaker underneath, and you have that vocal sample, that's constant. This constant sound that you hear underneath. That becomes a component of the beat itself. And then you have the hypersonic electro rhythm that they also, you know, looked into the composition of the beat. So it's African, it's European, it's everything in between. And so Now I want to play this because I wanted to point out something about the geography of language itself, but I'll do that briefly because of our time. So you, in this particular beat composition, you can hear the shaker, the sh, sh, sh sound, you know, consistent, and that lays the tempo for the clap sequence and the reverb and delay. And then most importantly, the Afro-Latin cleave and that you hear there, that's like the salsa-like Afro-Latin rhythm blended into it. And now this is just a sound. I want us to listen to the sound with the artist's vocals on it. All bad fella, what you suffer fit? With the bad, do with it, but you forget. All I told you, I'm a body boy yet. Oh, I told you, I'm a body boy yet. I told you, I'm a body boy yet. Yeah, body boy yet. Yeah, I'm a body boy yet. Yeah, what's the plan? Yeah, what's the plan? Yeah, plan. The singer sings in Yoruba and a mixture of Yoruba, Nigerian Pidgin, and English, and it blends it seamlessly and it with the end rhymes in a way that kind of like maps for us, you know, the Africanness of the lyrics, but also something that is propelling the lyrics, which is the beat. That is a composition from different elements of music from different parts of the world, making up that sound. And if you don't need to speak Yoruba to dance to this, if it comes on, you know, at a party, or maybe you just randomly found it on YouTube and you're playing it, and because it's actually orients your ear to a particular wave length, a particular mood of excitement and all of that. And basically the artist is saying that, oh, you know, I'm on fire, I've elevated, you know, all these people who have like bad intentions towards me, like they have actually transcended the level that they can come close. And so these sounds from, you know, Latin America, from different parts of culture, the Yoruba culture, which also influences this artist's his artistry, all play out in showing the fluidity of sound and the access the music producer has to these other cultural influences that build a kind of network of sociality around which, you know, we as listeners participate and engage in the rhythm. And if you have some time, I encourage you to listen to the music and read the comments, and you can tell how people are relating to it. And also, you know, like Kizomba is another sound that I want to touch on briefly to explain this composition and the way, you know, there's this fluidity of sound that plays out. You know, for it, the beat is the foundation of the music, and it goes without saying that once musicians lace it with their voice, the vibe produced is a very kind of like familiar yet unfamiliar in the sense of how they kind of like mix all these influences together. For instance, Kizomba, the slow sensuous dance music from Angola, the music is usually sung in Portuguese, but sometimes some artists mix it with Kibundu, a majority Bantu Angolan language. And, you know, there's the evolved dance style that accompanied Kizomba sound has a French imprint on it. And also the traditional Angolan semba, Cape Verdean percussions, rap and R&B and other ethnic instrumentations across Lusophone Africa influence the music itself for its slow tempo and bounce. You know, Semba's upbeat vibration also gave birth to the Brazilian samba, which was the sound that enslaved Africans from Angola took with them to the Americas in the transatlantic slave trade in the 17th century. In its updated version called Urban Modern Kizomba, is both influenced by a variety of sounds, including rumba, but it still maintains its baseline Angolan rhythm traceable to semba. So without exaggerating, Kizomba and its sonic materiality is perhaps Angola's global cultural exports. You know, the popularity of this sound in different parts of the world is actually fascinating. And let me just play this one track and I wrap up.
and his friend Antonio Ralph. So please feel free to dance, because tonight is his home night. Just another track.
Contigo que eu faria a minha vida, mas comigo não dá. Não me leva mal, me vai não dá. Você me faz dormir mal. Minha mãe perguntou: essa mulher é qual? Você me faz comer mal. Filha da caixa, você vai me matar. Perigosa.
Se não fugir, ela vai me matar.
Perigosa.
So, in your spare time, you can get the music on YouTube. It's freely available and listen to it. So, to like put a cap on everything, the Afropolitan soundscape complicates the question of African authenticity. As I've tried to show you in different examples, the sounds produced are at once African and global, local and universal, familiarly unfamiliar in their appeal. Rather than seeking authenticity, what should be more pressing for scholars and critics, I think, is a focus on the aesthetics of the sounds and reconnecting with the old Atlantic and the new African diaspora that creates new meanings of Africanness outside the cultural nativist paradigm. Critics should also invest in tracking how the sounds are changing the music landscape globally. What does this new regime of sound portend for opening up spaces that were otherwise closed to non-Europeans and non-American popular music culture and audience? In this current global flow and network, we can pay attention to insights on how the vibes in the music are organizing global Africa to create the possibility of distribution of wealth and resources, which is one of the cardinal projects of Afropolitanism as it happens in the current present time. So thank you so much for listening to my boring and long winding presentation. I hope, you know, you picked a thing or two, and I look forward to the questions and comments and how you perceive some of these ideas. And thanks, Dr. Levine, for the opportunity to make this presentation.
No problem. And it wasn't long or boring at all. In fact, the reason I didn't stop you was because we were so engrossed by it. I'm just going to stop your sharing quickly.
Okay.
Okay, great. Okay, and we have Hunter's had to go out a bit, but he just wants us to say thank you for your contribution and for the presentation, which I think was wonderful. Which is why I didn't want to stop you, and unfortunately we had to just because of time. So I think what we will do, unless anyone has pressing questions, there are a couple. So I think what we'll do, let's just see if we have any specific questions that we should address now. Okay, but you can also see them in the Q&A as well. And you can write your responses to them. There's just a couple that I thought were quite interesting. Wasn't exactly questions so much as they were requests. Well, firstly, Austin, I'm just going to ask you Austin's question very quickly, just because it's an interesting one. He says, there's plenty of non-essentialist ethno-literature out there. And I'm not sure why the discipline itself has become a straw man in this particular presentation. And he says, Z. Garcia, Monson, Cherry's edited collections, Eshun, Welele, and the work being done by young ethnographers who are directly engaged with communities. Do you want to respond to that?
Can you read that question again?
Okay, it's quite a tongue twister. So there's plenty of non-essentialist ethno-literature out there. I'm not sure why the discipline itself has become a straw man in this presentation. And he says, C. Garcia, Monson, he's listed, Cherry's edited collection, Eshun, and the work being done by young ethnographers who are directly engaged with communities?
I mean, like, you know, that's a very good question, especially for, you know, ethnographic research. And, you know, sometimes in the process of, you know, engaging with communities, there's a way that you want to, let me just say this statement again. Africa has always been modern, end of period. So that has to be the statement through which your research go, you know, connects. So even like when you are looking at maybe like a traditional dance in a village in maybe Kenya, you know, you are not saying, oh, this dance is so, you know, essential to this point, because when you even think about different dance movements that we are seeing from Shaku Shaku to Guara Guara to, you know, all these different dance movements, all of those elements are in it because there's a way that the movement is revived. So I think what should change is the methodology. And I've read some of the, some anthropologists on the continent actually who are arguing against Western anthropological methodology for reading cultural phenomena in communities. And that is important because we, you know, as a young scholar, you have to carve your own theory. Your work should be a work of theory, even though you are analyzing this text. So when you now take, you know, some ethnographic idea from 1950s that has a different agenda or a different goal, and you are mapping it on something that you're studying now, what you're doing is that you are reproducing that stamp that may essentialize the idea, even though what you're trying to do is to break out of it. And so, you know, when I mention cultural nativist, I also talked about cosmopolitan nativism, which also liberates, you know, you from confining yourself to that box that, you know, some of these scholarship, older scholarships have created for you as a mode of reading the phenomenon you are interacting with. So that's the way I don't know if that answers the question.
I think it does. So I'm just gonna, what I'm going to suggest we do, we have one new message. Let me just check here. In terms of questions. Well done. Tony, yes, it is being recorded. We will convert it to a YouTube video. It'll be on our YouTube channel, and it will also be on our seminar website. So it'll be available there. There's also been a request here from Janine. Okay, I'm just going to read it to you because I think it'll give you a bit of work, but let me just find it. Sorry, Leslie. Okay. She said it would be very helpful to see a list of the artists you refer to by section. Could you perhaps draw up a list?
Of the artists?
Yes, by section so that we can research and listen to them. So essentially what she wants is a list that she can, could you draw up a list? And maybe what we can do is we can circulate that for everyone who's been in the webinar today.
Yeah.
And I think what we should also do, if you're comfortable with it, just in case people have questions, people have had to drop off, I can put them in contact with you, send them your email, and then if they have any questions, I can contact you. Does that work?
Yeah, that's okay. I'll try as much as I can to respond. I mean, it could be maybe delayed a day or two. I usually respond to emails quickly. But also,
yeah, you do. Life happens. Life happens. But you do respond to emails quite quickly. So
yeah. So I'll do my best to respond. And I mean, if I have people who also want to share some stuff with me, or you know, ways that I could also bring another angle to it, I'll be happy to take both that as well.
Great. So what I'll do, what I'll do is I'll send a group email to everyone that was at this webinar today, and I'll just send them your email, tell them when the recording will be up, and then just if you can, just help maybe put together some of those artists so I can circulate it to people as well. Mm-hmm. And then, okay. Well, thanks to everyone who stayed the course. I think none of us wanted this presentation to end, so which is why I said to you, go on, which is why I didn't stop you. I think it was fantastic. I just wouldn't really use the essence of it. And I almost feel like we need a part two. But thank you. It was a great presentation. I think it was very illuminating for all of us. I think for those of us who are in the literature field, it touches on a lot of what we study as well. There's like a lot of intersections with the work I do. As we said, this will be recorded and it will be put up on our website. And also thank you to Hunter, I'm not sure if Hunter's back, but Hunter for putting us in touch with Deepo in the first place. And our next webinar will be in September and the focus will be on media diplomacy. So it'll be a very exciting topic. And Bob Borchessa, who's with research and partnerships at our center, will be on that panel. So please do attend that one. I will send more information about that one when it's available. And then we also have a literature one in October. So thank you very much for coming and staying the course, everyone. And enjoy the rest of the day. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you. And thank you so much, Deepa, for everything. What a great presentation.
Thank you.
And Leslie's saying, yes, a part two. We need to have a part two.
Oh, yeah. I mean,
let's see what we can do to make that happen. Let's see what we can do to make that happen. Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Thanks so much. I'm just going to, thanks. Thanks, everyone. Hey, enjoy the rest of the day.